than you take. And if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. When your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there people like you.
can you stand? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Also, Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. As we are gathered to give thanks to God for the life and witness of our brother Corey, I extend a greeting to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I am assisted by my brother, Reverend Bean of the Holy Trinity Anglican Church, and he will now receive the body for burial. So would you kindly remain standing while my brother receives Corey's body for burial.
With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother Corey Andre MacDonald. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Corey Andre MacDonald. We thank you for giving him to us as family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless mercy, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Remain seated, standing as we sing the opening hymn on page 2 in your leaflet, "And Can It Be?"
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Corey Andre MacDonald, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, he may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. I invite you to sit now for the reading of the first lesson, to be followed by a tribute by Sister Catherine Payne.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 to 3. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of the righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified, the word of the Lord.
Good morning to Corey's family and to what became his new world, Rita. I would like to say thank you for allowing Digicel and the Digicel business team to be a part of today. Corey's team wrote some thoughts and some sentiments and feelings that they all share, which we wanted to share with you today. As we gather here today in reflection, our hearts heavy with the weight of loss, we embark on a journey of remembrance and gratitude for Corey, a figure whose presence graced our lives, a true professional, manager, a mentor for many, and a cherished friend. Corey's departure has left a void that words struggle to express, yet in this tribute we aim to honor the profound impact he had on each of us, both professionally and personally. Corey's heart overflowed with care, compassion, radiating a light that touched the lives of everyone that he encountered. Even after a full day's work, he could be seen often grinning from ear to ear, gently chuckling and helping the younger ones in the office who would have come in after school with their homework. He would break down the questions, presenting them in a different manner as he guided them not only to the right answer, but understanding why that answer was correct. His selflessness knew no bounds as he consistently took of his own time to help others in need. Whether you just had gotten a new device, couldn't figure out how to get it configured, needed additional muscle to assist with an arduous task, and I've asked him to help me move many boxes, or even if you found yourself broken down on the side of the road at the end of the day with a phone call, he would be there. He was a pillar of support and encouragement in times of adversity and a source of genuine happiness in times of joy. Corey was a proud supporter of work-life balance. And he would often say to us, folks, we work extremely hard at the end of the day, so when we have the opportunity to enjoy yourselves arise, when that opportunity arises, you should take it. And we did. Certainly he did with his team. Certainly we did as a department as often as we could. And that's exactly what we did together with him, whether at our occasional social gatherings outside of the office or entertainment events, specifically those hosted by events which he was a part of. Both Corey and Rhea could be found adding liveliness to the atmosphere and a spark to the conversation. It was also discovered that he was a man of hidden talents, as he stepped right up to the microphone during a particular karaoke session and thrilled those in attendance with his performance of Josh Turner's Your Man. There was seemingly very little that this gentle giant of a man could not do well. Corey found solace and joy in sports and video games, whether on the hockey court or the digital PlayStation realm. His passion for hockey, basketball, football, and online gaming was infectious and brought many people together in the spirit of friendly rivalry and shared excitement. His dedication to hockey also extended far beyond the court. When he was injured and unable to play, he was always there in the stands cheering on his UWI Blackbirds with the same level of enthusiasm as if he was on the field himself. When it came to basketball, LeBron James stood at the center of Corey's basketball universe. No matter what team LeBron played for or who he was up against, Corey always believed that he was the best. And then there was cricket, a sport that always held a special place in Corey's heart. Despite the heights and lows that came with supporting the West Indies cricket team, through many defeats and few victories, like most of us from the Caribbean, he stood by the West Indies cricket team. For him, it was more than just a game. It was a celebration of culture, community, especially when we all reminisce about the good old days when Brian Lara and Curtly Ambrose played. In addition to his love for playing hockey, he enjoyed going to the gym. For Corey, the gym was more than just a place to enhance his physique, and he had a big one. This is where he formed a community who shared his passion for self-improvement and growth. Among many of his remarkable feats, his ability to bench press 2 100-pound dumbbells effortlessly remains shocking to this day, especially when you consider that Corey had only eaten 2 steamed dumplings, a piece of broccoli, and a small piece of chicken for lunch that day. His strength was not confined to the gym alone, as there were times when he competed in a few health and wellness competitions at work, single-handedly winning the men's push-up and skipping challenges and leading his team to victory in the tug of war. Now, in tug of war, Corey considered 2 or 3 people versus him oneself to be fair, but to us, it felt unfair because usually he won within 5 to 10 seconds. Beyond his athletic pursuits, Corey was also a mentor, a guiding force who inspired and empowered those around him to reach their full potential. And there are many in the team who benefited from this. Before Corey was promoted to service delivery and support manager, he would always declare if there was anyone that needed his help, his office door was open, even though he was sitting in a mirror cubicle like the rest of us. For those who were fortunate to shadow Corey on a few projects, and by his own interpretation, that meant to participate in the actual work, his expertise was invaluable. It was an invaluable lifeline. Whenever an installation became complex and riddled with challenges, his response was always, okay, it's time for you to sink or swim, or you'll figure it out. He had full faith in our ability to get the job done. No matter what challenges we face, with his unwavering patience and wisdom, he nurtured the talents and aspirations of the entire team, instilling the confidence and resilience needed to navigate through our daily tasks at work. Whether it was leading us through the complexities of a project or offering counsel in times of uncertainty, Corey always stood as the voice of reason. Although Corey may no longer walk among us, his spirit lives in the countless lives he touched, the hearts he uplifted, and the memories he forged with most of us in this room today. As we bid farewell to his towering presence, let us carry forth his legacy of compassion, kindness, resilience, receptiveness, to ensure that his light continues to shine brightly in our lives and the world beyond. Rest easy, dear friend. It was a true joy knowing you, and we forever are grateful for the memories you've shared with us. As you did, they will forever stand tall in our hearts.
Let me invite Sandra Lynch to come forward now and share with us the second lesson.
The second reading is taken from the book of Revelations, chapter 21, verse 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first earth and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." The word of the Lord.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thine hand has made, I see the stars, I hear the roaring thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed, then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee, how great thou art. Let us stand and sing the hymn, "How Great Thou Art," on page 3 in your leaflets, page 3.
Thank you.
We shall now have reflections on Corey's life, and who can do this better than Mom? But Mom has given this over to Dad and Big Brother. And so we invite Daddy and Big Brother to come forward and share reflections on his life. Jay McDonald, Goddard, now we should say a senior, and Kurt. Would you kindly sit then, please? And I await Dad to say who will go first.
Good morning to Corey and Rhea's families, their friends, colleagues, and all who have come to pay their respects to our son, Corey. This is not intended to be a eulogy, but it is our attempt to summarize his 39 years of life. Corey Andre McDonald Goddard was born on Monday, December 3rd, 1984, at 6:05 p.m., to his parents, Anthea and Jay McDonald Goddard, bringing more Yuletide joy to his doting parents, his sibling Kirk, and to Auntie Claudette, whose birthday is December 2nd. As his father, my greatest delight was hearing him say his first recognizable word. And you guess what it was, Dad. Corey developed into a happy, healthy, fun-loving toddler who liked to tease his elder brother, Kirk. Sometimes he would sit on Kirk's infant chair, and then he would call up, "Kirk, look," just to fret Kirk. And Kirk would start to cry sometimes, or he would fret. And Corey would be there smiling. On one such occasion, Kirk, instead of crying, might have hit him. I didn't say he hit him, but he might have hit him. And Corey cried out. In came Mom. And without asking any questions, assumed that Kirk had hit Corey, and she gave Corey a slap. This startled Master Kirk. Give Kirk a slap. Thank you very much for that. This startled Master Corey. And after a while, he waved his finger at his mom and said, "Mom, let me tell you something. Don't you ever hit my brother again." And you know what happened. That was followed by a slap to Corey. By this time, they were both crying, and the endearing Corey just hugged and kissed his brother, and off they went, comforting each other. In preparing this tribute, Kirk reminded me that all the time they got into trouble, it was not always his fault, but Corey was often the instigator.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Corey spent two terms at the then Christ Church Boys School, where our mom taught, before joining me at the then St. Patrick's Primary. This was because our Auntie Thelma lived nearby and provided our after-school care. From the day Corey entered the gates of St. Patrick's Primary School, he became known to everyone, principal, teacher, ancillary staff, and students. Not only did everyone in the school know Corey, but they had to know that he was my brother. Our cousin Lucille was assigned to Corey's nursery class as part of her training in early childhood education. During an outdoor lesson one afternoon, an airplane flew over. She asked, "Do any of you know the name of the person given to the person who flies an airplane?" Master Corey answered, "Yes, a pilot." To which she asked, "How do you know that, Corey?" Corey looked at her sweetly, smiled, and quickly replied, "My daddy is one." She said to him, "Or is he a teacher?" Corey looked up at her, and with his compelling eyes and charming smile, he asked, "Who told you?" For him, our daddy was his hero. So much so that at one time, he had his classmates convinced that that the then UN Secretary General Kofi Annan was our dad's friend.
Corey was always a courageous, confident, and unique child. One who, in addition to excelling in academics, displayed strong leadership skills and excellent reasoning skills from an early age. It is my belief that had he continued to play cricket, he would have developed into an excellent captain and left-hand fast bowler for the West Indies cricket team. While he didn't captain the West Indies cricket team, he was deputy head boy in his final year at primary school. Corey and Kirk always looked out for each other and supported each other no matter what the situation was. When Corey was in class 3 at primary school and Kirk was in second form at secondary school, anytime Kirk was revising his work, Corey would be there to offer a helping hand. Believe it or not, in foreign languages. Never having done foreign languages at primary school. This is how he would do it. He would ask Kirk for the meaning of an English word in Spanish. And Kirk would give him this meaning of the English word. Corey, not knowing whether Kirk's pronunciation was correct, would say, "Spell it." After writing the common entrance exams, he obtained marks for Common Merit School. And after we congratulated him, Mom said to him, "I'm going to request a transfer to Foundation School for you." "Because it would be easier for you since your dad and your brother are there." The assertive master, Corey, said, "Mom, Kirk passed for Foundation and you sent him to Foundation. I passed for Common Merit and I want to go to Common Merit. The rest is history." At secondary school, Corey had a very hard act to follow. For by then, his brother was excelling at Christchurch Foundation School, placing first in form, first in exam, and first in year. Corey, who looked up to his brother, settled in quickly, and at the end of first term, he too placed first in form, thus proving that he was just as intelligent as Kirk.
That was a little debatable. Our mom likes to tell this story. When he was in second form, the music teacher gave the students in whom he had seen potential a musical instrument. Corey was given a trumpet. The students were informed that they would be responsible for the care and safekeeping of the instrument. The next day, Corey returned his instrument to the teacher. When our mom asked him why, he replied, "Look at it this way, Mom. I am saving you and Dad some money because I know that I am going to lose it." Corey progressed through school and up to fourth form. He performed well in all subjects except English literature. This caused our mom some concern, so in fifth form, off he went to literature lessons. After the first session, Mrs. Jordan, his lessons teacher, told them that they had nothing to fear, that Corey was very intelligent and that he would do well. Meanwhile, our mom complained that she was not seeing Corey do any work at home and that she would be willing to set him up to sell fruits on the opposite side of the road where a fruit vendor was already established. To this came the witty reply, "Mom, you don't see me doing work because I understand the work. And when I get back my results, I don't want to hear you showing off to your friends about me." When the results were announced, he had passed all 8 subjects, attaining 6 grade 1s and 2 grade 2s, having been awarded grade 1 in English literature. This is what Master Corey had to say to both his mom and lessons teacher, Mrs. Jordan. "Well, as long as I live, I will never read another literature book."
In sixth form, he did computer science, mathematics, and physics, and received excellent results, so off to university he would go. By this time, his older brother had recently returned home after completing studies at Mona and was contemplating going off to England to do his master's. When Corey heard of his plans, his response was, "Mom, something wrong with this boy head. He told me that when he was in Jamaica, he had to cook and wash for himself. And now he wants to go off to England? Well, I ain't going anywhere but Cayville because life too sweet at home. So he proceeded to Cayville and pursued a degree in his first love, computer science, and at my urging, mathematics, earning academic awards every year and graduating with first class honors.
While Corey was studying at UE, our home would be inundated with his classmates, both males and females, coming to learn at his feet. Our mother would sometimes tell him that he was spending too much time helping his friends and not enough doing his work, to which he replied, "Mom, the more you explain it to them, the better I get to understand it." His friend Neil said that at Cayville, when they complained about how difficult a course was, Gotti, as he was affectionately called, would also complain. However, when the results of the exams were returned, you would be sure to see an A next to Gotti's name, while the rest of them had to settle for lesser grades. He also said that there was a particular course they all avoided and tried to persuade Gotti not to do it. He said Gotti did that course, and at the end of the day, he got a grade A. While they all did not fare as well in the alternative course, which they had opted to do. After graduation, Corey worked at Fujitsu Caribbean Barbados Limited for 7 years before joining the staff of Digicel Barbados Limited, where he worked in several capacities until his promotion to business service, delivery, and support manager, a position he held until his untimely passing. Our home is filled with many certificates of appreciation from Digicel's customers, as well as several awards of excellence from the company.
Corey followed in the footsteps of many Commonwealthians, and after graduation, he took up the sport of field hockey, where he not only represented the UWA Blackbirds team in his Gotti 12 jersey, but also undertook the responsibility of ensuring that the team's uniforms were laundered and ready for the next day's game, thus making our laundry room the team's official laundromat. Hockey gave Corey the opportunity to travel, and as he would have competed in overseas hockey tournaments.
Immediately, the tour of the USA comes to mind. All went well, but on their return to the island, our mother was shocked to learn that while on that tour, the team rented a coach to get around. When asked if they had to get a driver as well, Corey responded that he and Bradley were the drivers. I don't have to tell you that our mother almost had a heart attack. She said, "Corey, you mean to tell me that you never drove a coach in Barbados and went driving one through the busy streets of America, Manhattan, of all places?" He retorted, "There's no difference, Mom. It's just that they drive on the wrong side of the road." Corey had many friends, but I believe the one who was closest to him, almost like a brother, was Bradley Harris, whom he met in first form. Anytime one called the other for any help, you would be sure that the help would be there in no time. The Super Bowl game and NBA Finals were two of the many special events which Corey and his friends shared. On these occasions, they would all come to our home, literally taking over every conceivable space, thus banishing our mom and dad to their room.
Corey loved all of his family, especially his niece, Hannah, who saw him as her second dad and who was always extremely happy when Uncle Corey was around. He adored his parents and his elder brother, Kurt, who set a very high standard for him. I am pleased to say that he reached and in some instances surpassed each benchmark set by his brother.
Debatable.
Not having any sisters, his sister-in-law Jamie shared a special bond. He affectionately called her Jay, and she in return called him Core. About 5 years ago, Corey met the beautiful young lady, Rhea Lynch, whom he introduced to us as his friend, because Rhea at first showed no interest in developing a relationship. However, Corey, determined as he was, did not give up. And after a few years, one morning he said to his mom that Rhea had finally agreed to be his girlfriend, to which his mother replied, "I'm happy for you." We could tell that they were truly in love, for whenever she was around, he was happier than ever. In fact, I would say that he was on cloud nine, and so was she. Soon after, Corey started the process of acquiring a house for his wife, for by then she was regarded to him, and this goal was realized. Corey possessed and exemplified many positive and outstanding attributes. He based his life on the Christian principles of kindness, love, honesty, trustworthiness, and respect for others. He was reliable, friendly, helpful, and God-fearing, all virtuous qualities which he developed in his formative years from the example set at home and while attending Sabbath school with his aunts Linda and Claudette. He would be the one to lend a helping hand, as attested to by Catherine, when anyone needed it. He was a true professional, dedicated to duty, and had a very pleasant personality, which endeared him to everyone with whom he came in contact. Corey was extremely intelligent, yet very humble, a quality admired by his many peers. He was witty and used his wit to enliven the many family gatherings over the years. And Catherine alluded to this. Most of you wouldn't know, but among all things, Corey was a singer. He could serenade you with his melodious voice. And Rhea can attest to this, for she has at least one recording of him serenading her. She has promised to share it with the rest of the family. She hasn't shared it yet. Corey has in some way impacted the lives of many. Each of us has many pleasant memories of him. Today, as we celebrate his life, I leave you with the words of his dear niece Hannah, who on hearing of his passing said, "Mom, let us think of all the good things about Uncle Corey. Sleep easy, son. Rest assured that you're loved by your soulmate, Rhea, your moms, Anne and Sandra, your dads, Jay MacDonald and Edmund, your brother, Kirk, his wife, Jamie, your niece, Hannah, aunts, Evelyn, Thelma, Claudette, Linda, Nola, Erlin, Denise, uncles, Hallam, Adolphus, and Keith, your cousins, Greg and Ryan, who are like brothers, and Ryan's wife, Shanika, your other cousins, Hugh, Marion, Lorna, Marva, Margaret, Margot, Marianne, Marcia, Angus, Gail, Brenda, Kevin, Joshua, Delissa, Katrina, Kadeem, Nigel, Ingrid, Kevin, Ian, and there are many others. So, Keith and Arundel, who are here, and many others too numerous to mention. Your brother-in-law, Ryan, his wife, Latoya, and their daughter, Maya, and your very special friends, Bradley, John, and Marlon, as well as the many other friends and colleagues with whom you were associated. To my colleagues who study Latin, I leave you this phrase, Semper amabimus dulciter redentis, dulciter cantantis cori, which translates, we will always love the sweetly smiling, sweetly singing Corey. Fare thee well, son.
Until we meet again, up and on.
And you are permitted to remain sitting, though in your minds you want to be up and on. The Combermere group, I shan't use the word posse, that would be yesterday. The Combermere group will be singing up and on at the graveside, and all being provided for you. We foundationites know what it means to do things in the way they should be done. Including those who will join us for the annual meeting later today. You raised me up. Andre, would you be so kind as to share with us and lift our spirits? Thank you.
Good morning. there's a track.
There's a track that to be used for the singing, and we haven't received. We're locating where it is. Otherwise, while it's being located, we can move on and then come back to it. You raise me up. It's not here at the moment, or you can go without.
I can go without.
Yes. You sound like an up and on person. Thank you, sir.
Very well. I'll sing it without.
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Thank you so much, and being very conscious of time, I invite you now in a prayerful way to approach God's throne of grace as I share with you the sermon and address. I speak in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. My Christian people, the first lesson is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through to a section that is a little shorter than we would love. But what it does, it contains a section I'm going to quote from and preach for you. That is, it says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because he has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good tidings, good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They shall be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory." Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through to 3. You would recall that passage from Isaiah is reflected in Luke's Gospel chapter 4. After the temptations, Jesus begins his ministry and he is in his hometown. He is in his hometown, and there he uses these words again. And those who are keen Bible students would know that we say that the Missio Dei, the mission of God, comes through to us through the Missio Christi, Christ's mission. So that what we are called to be as Christians is summed up in this mission. And that our whole life is to be the outpouring of these tasks given to us by God in Isaiah and reflected by Jesus' affirmation of them. So that we who are called by God as Christians through our baptism into the death and resurrection of Jesus the Christ should see whatever we do in this regard. Earlier today, after the first reading, we had a representative of Digicel flanked by two ministering angels, the Angeloi, to use the Greek language, flanked by two ministering angels, sharing with us something of the life and work of our brother. And some of the purists would say, but in the midst of the readings, in the midst of those holy words, we're going to talk about work. Indeed, we must. We must because we who are called by God expected on earth to do what God would have us and what God wants. And so the work we do, that some people would say doesn't seem like sacred work, it is in fact the work of God. So that whether you work at Digicel or a few months ago when we buried Corey's aunt, Norma, from this place, reflected on the work she did in association with Carter's, certain Carter's and Company and Pilgrim Road, etc. We were reflecting on what God wanted persons to do. They were called by God to exercise God's ministry here on earth. And this is what is critical for us. Now, we like to think that we are given 70. And sometimes, perhaps another 10, or as someone we know from not far from here, where the family came from, Brother Small, who is 103, and was 103 just about a week ago. So we might have more than that 70, but the reality is, between birth and death, that dash represents the time God has given us to do God's work. What is that work to which you are committed? Is it like Corinne's parents, my former neighbor, Jay MacDonald, as a teacher, and cousins, our sister Lucille and others? Is it as a teacher? Is it in the field of technology, where they're helping us to perhaps even peer in the distant realm of the solar system? And there, we discover what God has done. We are discovering more and more the wonderful marvels of God. And whatever it is, or maybe politics. And if you say politics, and not politics. Time is short. Whatever it is, my friends, let us put our hands and our minds to it. And let us recognize that we are doing God's work. And the extent to which we are going to be involved in lifting up persons, helping them to become what God wants them to be, is the extent to which God's work is being done on earth. Thy kingdom come on earth, the Malkuth Adonai, the Basileia Tou Theou is coming on earth, as it is, in fact, present in heaven. So each one of us should feel proud about the work we do. And we like to begin this at school by saying, enjoy school. I'm so upset when persons feel, no, there's nothing to enjoy about school. I don't mean the teasing. You're going to get that too. And little pranks you play, you're sitting there, or you, someone comes and meets you as you go to the staff room, as they did when I taught at St. Gabriel's and little element at Queen's College sometime, and we leave teaching there, and they'll come in, what you may take your bags there, say, what prank is being prepared? I was there too. But whatever it is, we are called to do God's work here on earth. Let us be resolved to do this. And I like to say to those who are chaplain to the Barbados Workers Union, I always remind them, yes, we will agitate for good benefits, but ensure that you are doing God's work, wherever you are. I bless God, and it's been very painful to hear of and to experience this death. The family has been known to us, to our neighbors for years, etc. It's all part of that Pilgrim Road, Parishland, Ballsland, Providence community. And it is painful. And by extension now, up the Holy Trinity and, yeah, we are complete. But my friends, as we have occasion, as we embrace through the schools, Foundation, Combermere, other schools, all the Combermere's here, like all my children went there, so Combermere. In fact, they said, yeah, you were one of you see you went to Foundation, but you're really a Combermerean, yeah. Yeah, up and on. But we like to anchor ourselves first in the Foundation, and then you can look up and on and try to be clear. You know? It is like the persons in, you know, they used to say of a certain part of Barbados and St. Peter, and you're behind God's back. You know what they taught me down at St. Philip de Les Boscobel? But Archdeacon, Venerable, isn't that where you're supposed to be? You're not supposed to be in front of God's face. God leads and you follow, so you're behind God's back. Wisdom. Transformation, that is what we are called to do. So I ask you, my brothers and sisters, as we share with each other, and yes, I really need the smiles because, yeah, my friends, let us bless God and bless each other and make this nation the nation where we, as people of God, can relate to each other, can use those ties of blood, I'm going to use the fancy terms, but use those ties of school, etc., not to exclude, but to embrace. To embrace. Yesterday, when I left the funeral here, and on my way home to get some lunch, it was after 3 o'clock, and I stopped at the funeral home with the viewing from our brother and to be there with the family. I didn't get home till after 7. But there you saw the way in which persons from all the communities that were touched by our brother came together, and some persons were bawling. That's okay on the graveside. It's okay, let it out. Because we want to share what God has done through the life of our brother Corey. And as he received those values taught to him at home, in his community, yeah, his community, where he grew up. This morning we had to shorten our walk. We were in St. Joseph because there were persons who were coming here, part of that walking community, etc. All here and some online. That is what life is about. So that when times like this come, we're here to be strong for each other. So my friends, let us bless God. And that Spirit of God who has spoken through, I trust through me, may strengthen you to help these servants of God bear their loss. And help us bear our loss. That is what it's all about. Amen.
I invite you now to stand with me as we turn to page 4 in your leaflet and affirm our faith in the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. Page 4. I believe in God, the Father Almighty. Remain standing as we pray for the family and friends of our dearly departed brother. This is, of course, as Archdeacon said, a bitter, but yet still a sweet day. Bitter in the sense of that the pain is real, the void is real. The sting of death has come. It's a person that cannot be replaced. But it's also sweet in that he lived, that he passed this way. It's sweet in that I'm sure we can't think of life without him. And so we give God thanks that he came and left some powerful memories with us. Sweet in that he touched so many lives. Sweet that for us as Christians, life has changed, not ended. There is a story of a person at night lighting a candle because it was dark, and the candle was needed in the darkness. But then as the sun came up, it was extinguished, because a greater light had come. And so if you can see death in that sense, that a greater light has come, therefore the light that we had is extinguished and gives way to the greater light. We pray now for the family and friends. I ask you to respond to each petition by saying, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Friends, we pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you, Lord, in your mercy. Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, may we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in the fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to be in your fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, show your mercy to the dying. Strengthen them with your hope and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence, Lord, in your mercy. We command all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we share with them in your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Father of all, we pray to you for our dearly departed brother, Corey, and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them, and may he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We prepare now to take the bier of our brother out. As we prepare to do so, there is a recessional song that was recorded and it's requested. This is Why I Love You. So as we take the bier of our body out and the pallbearers follow the Reverend Bernard Bean and I, we ask that you, in the usual, very decent manner in which we do so, take our brother out and support each other with love. I do, on behalf of my entire family, our household, indeed, I can truly say on behalf also of my esteemed colleague, the Reverend Bernard Bean, and his family, extend our deepest condolences to all members of the family, and that includes the school family, the university family, etc., of our brother Corey Andre MacDonald. God bless and keep you as we take our bear, the body out to his graveside, where you'll be joining us.
And I've learned to love me too. Never have I felt that I could be all that you see. It's like our hearts have intertwined into the perfect harmony. This is why I love you. Ooh, this is why.
Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let thy perpetual shine upon me. May he rest in peace.
In you, and no other love will do. Thank you.
Thank you.
floral tributes using the carnations. So those who will be putting the carnations onto the bear, kindly, you will get the assistance of the attendants to ensure that you are able to climb the ramp appropriately and place your carnations and then return to your places. Could we do that then? And there will be some more music while that is being done. Thank you.
Wait for you, so go on, go on. that we lost it. We stood on the ceilings. You showed me love was all you needed. Heaven couldn't wait for you.
Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower he blossoms, then withers. Like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn to for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at the last hour, let us not fall away from you.
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Corey Andre MacDonald, and we commit his body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and we beseech your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this, our brother Corey, and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord. May he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. Amen.
Thank you.
cheering is the Christian's hope. The hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. To God be the glory, great things he has done.
Thank you. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Of God, I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and in darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your
let us pray. Father of all, by whose mercy and grace your saints remain in everlasting light and peace, we remember with thanksgiving those whom we love but see no longer. And we pray that in them your perfect will may be fulfilled. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.